Hi, I'm Micah Woods. Today, I'm at Brookside Laboratories, and I would like to show you what happens from the time a sample arrives at the laboratory and goes through all the steps to get tested for things like pH, soil potassium, soil organic matter, and so on. I am joined today by Liz Skinner, the
Soils Lab Manager.
The Soils Lab Manager. She's going to give us a tour.
All right, let's head inside.
Let's go.
Okay. Samples are received daily at Brookside. They come out here on the conveyor belt. Technicians from the appropriate labs will come out and collect the samples. These are soil samples. So we'll place them on our cart and head into the unpacking room.
Unpacking and drying.
Correct.
So samples will be dried in here because soil samples need to be dry when they are
prior tested. To grinding.
Yep.
So we open up the box, we look for our worksheet, we put the samples in the order that they're on the worksheet. Placed on our drying racks until they're deemed dry.
You can hear the fans moving the air around to dry these samples out. So then when the samples are dry, then we go grind them.
Correct. Let's head into the grinding room.
So the grinding is done to homogenize the samples and also to remove any material that is not soil. The soil needs to have any undecomposed living and dead plant material. Any gravel and rocks won't be included. So you'll get stems and sticks and pieces of gravel, stuff like that, will get removed during the grinding process. So you get these bigger chunks of material that's not really soil because it's bigger than a piece of sand.
After the samples have been ground and sieved to 2 millimeters, they're taken to the scheduling table where the samples are scheduled into our LIM system and assigned a lab number.
So we'll just come out of the drying room and go across the hallway. To the scheduling room. And the samples actually go into, what do you call these trays?
We call them our muffin tins.
Muffin tins.
So the samples are scheduled in the computer system and they're assigned a lab number that corresponds with the number on the muffin tin. The technicians take the sample and put the appropriate sample into the corresponding muffin tin.
And there are some quality control checks that go in also, which we've talked about quite a bit today.
Yes, so we run a blind QC sample approximately every 50 samples. it's a way of ensuring that the instrumentation and the extraction process is on point. So these muffin pans will start to circulate from technician to technician, and they will extract for the test method that they've been assigned. This is malic extraction. It's a 1 gram scoop of soil placed in the designated extracting vessel. So once she has extracted around 90 samples, malic free extracting solution will then be applied to the samples.
So there's 1 gram of soil in each of these.
Correct. With 10 mLs of malic free extracting solution. And then the samples will go on to the orbital shaker.
Okay, this already has some trays set up.
Trays are set up.
And then we would also have scoops for organic matter and for pH. Do you want to show that?
Yes.
So this tray, the muffin tin continues around.
So we're going to scoop for pH, which is a 1:1. So she's going to place 7 grams of soil into the designated cup. And then we will eventually add 7 mLs of DI water. Stir the sample, let it rest, and then test the sample on our robots.
And one of these happens to be a quality control check.
Correct.
But at this point, nobody knows which one is which.
Correct.
You just know it by number.
We will know at the end of the day when we review the data. We will check and ensure that all of our quality control samples are within our designated ranges. Before our samples are approved for the day.
And now we have the
organic matter.
And these are called crucibles?
Yes.
And they're gonna go in a muffle furnace and be burned at 360 degrees Celsius overnight?
Correct. First we'll capture a dry weight. So the samples after they're scooped will go in the drying oven where they will dry for approximately an hour. After the samples are dry, they'll go onto one of our robots. We will collect a dry weight. Once the weight is collected, the samples will then go into a 360C oven where they will ash overnight. And then we'll come back in the morning, weigh those samples on the same robot the initial weight was captured on.
All right. And if you're doing the regular soil testing package here, they'd also get a scoop for a Bray-1 phosphorus extractor,
correct,
right?
Yes, which is very similar to how we scoop for the malic, but we can scoop for Bray.
And so the typical soil sample is going to get 4 scoops of that tin.
It depends on which test package was selected.
Okay. All right. What's next? Are we going to do the Bray scoop?
Sure.
So this is the scheduling room, but it's also a sample scooping.
It's where we start the extraction process.
And you're doing, on a typical day, how many samples would run through here?
Anywhere between 2,000 and 4,000.
Wow. That's a lot of samples.
Yes. So after the samples are extracted per the testing method, the samples are filtered into test tubes and placed on the appropriate instrumentation. Another test offered here at Brookside Labs is saturated soil. What we do here, we take 200 to 250 grams of soil. We place it in a cup. If irrigation water was provided by the client, we will saturate with irrigation water. Otherwise, we use DI water. We mix it to a pancake-like consistency. The sample will then rest overnight. In the morning, we come back in and we place it in the top of the extracting vessel, which works on a vacuum. It will pull the liquid portion out of that pancake batter consistency into the beaker. And then the liquid portion is what is placed on our instrumentation for testing. This is one of our instrument rooms. In this oven are the organic matter samples. This is where we would place the samples to dry for approximately 1 hour. After the samples were dried, they would go on our organic matter robot. We would collect a dry weight. After the dry weight was collected, the samples would then go into one of our ashing ovens, where they ash at 360 degrees C. These would ash overnight. In the morning, we would come back in and place these samples on the same robot their dry weight was taken on and collect their ashed weight.
Oh, this robot is working. Pretty cool. So it's measuring, it looks like it's got four scales there, and it's measuring four samples at once?
Yes, so the robot will pick up four crucibles, take them to the scale, collect a weight, pick the crucible back up, return it to its original position, and then pick up the next four samples.
And you've got those quality control, checks in there of a known organic matter content.
Correct. The first five samples are a standard. So once we know our standards passed and all of our calibrations are in check, the robot is allowed to run its batch. We have a quality control sample every 50 samples, ensuring that all of our checks and balances are in place.
Cool. And then what about these robots over here?
These are pH robots. We have four pH probes per head. These robots have to pass their calibration prior to running any samples in the morning. And then once the robot has passed its calibration, it can read four samples at a time. So the head will pick up, go into the first four samples, the stir rods will kick on, it'll take the pH reading of four samples, it'll report it electronically into our computer system, and then the head will return to the wash position where it will wash off and then head out into the next four samples.
Now, these are the pH electrodes on this robot that measure the pH of the soil.
Correct. Every day when the technicians come in the morning, they will calibrate their robots. So what that means is the robot has to pass the calibration standards of 4, 7, and 10. After the robots have successfully calibrated, the technicians will start to extract samples. Before they put a batch of samples on the robots then have to pass standards of 5 and 9 in our in-house QC. Once the robots have been successfully calibrated and pass all of their calibration curves, the robot can then begin to test samples.
Wow, that's a lot of quality control.
It is a lot of quality control.
But yeah, that's important to make sure that the samples are giving accurate results.
Yes, it's to ensure that the instrumentation is set up correctly and that we pass all of our in-house QCs.
So now this is the pH robot. It passed all of its...
Passed its calibration. So it's going to head into the first four samples. The stir rods are going to kick on. It's going to take a reading. It'll head to the wash, clean itself off, and then read the next four samples.
So it's making a slurry. This is 7 milliliters of deionized water and 7 grams of soil. So it's a 1-to-1, and it's making a slurry. It's measuring the pH in that slurry with a well-calibrated electrode. And it's going to go rinse itself off now?
It goes to the rinse. It's sensing you.
Oh. It senses that I was too close.
Correct.
And now it's doing the next four samples. It sure beats doing it one by one manually, doesn't it?
It does. And the results are automatically captured in our computer system.
So those ones that I see right now, 7.16, 7.2, 7.24.
And then there's the ones that just drove.
Wow.
So it's in the wash. And then after it's done washing, it'll go into the next four samples. And the process will continue until the run is complete.
This was the instrumentation room?
We have two instrument rooms. This instrument room also has our flow injection analyzers, where we do the Bray 1, Bray 2, and Olsen phosphorus work, as well as our available nitrogen, ammonia, and chloride. So this flow injection analyzer is currently running. We'll head into another instrument room where our ICPs are.
Wow, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Are there 6 ICPs in here?
Correct, the soils lab has 6 ICPs.
Wow. ICP stands for inductively coupled plasma spectrometry?
Correct.
Yeah. And this heats things up really hot, doesn't it?
It does. So what happens with these instruments, the auto sampler will head into the designated sample. It'll pull up the allotted amount and inject it into the ICP. It'll come through the spread valve up into the tip where it's like a nebulizer. It turns it into a mist and pulls it up through the elbow and into the torch.
Do you happen to know how hot it is getting in the torch?
1500 degrees Celsius?
Yeah, something pretty hot.
Something pretty hot, yes.
And that excites the electrons of every atom to make a unique signature. That's the way I understand it.
Yeah, it excites the electrons, which causes a color reaction. And then there's cameras and software in the ICP that are picking up the color change and reporting the values into the computer system.
That's high technology. Wow, that's pretty cool. So this is kind of what happens at the end of every sample run after the nutrients have been extracted. So this is like your potassium.
Your plant available. So potassium, iron, zinc, magnesium, copper.
Calcium. Malic-3 phosphorus.
Yep. These instruments also have to pass a calibration before they're allowed to run, and we do also have our blind QC every 50.
This looks like a library of soil samples, Liz. What do we have here?
This is sample storage. So after the samples are done being tested, they're brought out here and they're stored for a minimum of 4 weeks. We can find your sample by referencing the report date and the lab number. And then we come out here, and whether the sample was quarantined or not tells us which section to look in. But here we have the date that the sample was reported, and these are the lab numbers. And then we would come out and pull the needed tote and find back the sample to perform any additional testing.
So that is a nice feature, that if the sample needs to be rechecked, that can be done.
Yes, rechecks, additional testing.
And what do you mean by quarantine?
So quarantine samples are samples that are not domestic here to this area. They are kept over here in a designated area. And once the samples have reached the maximum hold time, they are incinerated in our incinerator and disposed of.
So this is a global laboratory with samples coming in from all over the world?
Correct.
And when you say quarantine, it's those samples that are from outside the continental United States?
Yeah, outside the continental U.S. or from designated areas that require quarantine.
And so those samples need to be treated differently, so they're flagged as they go through, and then any residue and any excess sample will eventually be incinerated.
Correct. When the samples are received here at the lab, they are identified as quarantine samples throughout the entire process. Any sample that is quarantined any portion of that sample does have to be disposed of in a specific way involving incineration.
Can we go look at the incinerator?
Sure.
Do you happen to know what percentage of samples that the lab runs are international?
Not off the top of my head.
There's a good number in this storage area too. So these have all been tested already. This is the excess material that's just waiting in case it needs to be checked again.
Correct. These samples have completed the requested testing. We hold on to them for a minimum of 4 weeks, longer if we have the space, and then the sample is disposed of.
And then this is the incinerator right behind you. So then it gets incinerated, and then any pathogens or any type of unwanted
organisms have been destroyed, and then the samples are then disposed of.
Thank you. Wow, is this like a cupcake soil party? Wow. But there's soil in them.
There is. These samples have been, the testing has been completed just here recently in the last couple of days. So we like to hang on to them in their designated muffin tins until the sample needs to be dumped. That way, if you get your results and you check them right away and something isn't right, we can come right to the muffin pan and have a look at the sample.
Right. So there's all these different samples. So there's 12 different samples in this tray, and then all of these trays are filled.
Correct.
Right. So you can just do an immediate recheck if there's any question about it.
Yes.
Thank you, Liz. That was an amazing tour and a wonderful tour to see what happens to the samples as they go through the laboratory. Now, I'm in a completely different lab now. I'm now in the geotechnical lab, and I will save a video about that for another time. But now we know for the samples that come for pH, for soil organic matter, for soil nutrients, for that sort of thing, the process that they go through, you've just seen that in this video. I hope you enjoyed it.